Anyone ever get a song in their head and they just can't get rid of it? How many have had that experience? Oh man, this week I've had a song I can't get rid of. I just cannot get rid of that song. And so I think I'd like to share it with you. Would you like to join me? It goes something like this. You always have to be careful what you teach your children. This song goes back to when I was knee-high to a grasshopper. Those things we teach our children, that's why it's so important to have them in church. They come back and they build you up, and boy, they make a difference in your life. So this song goes something like this. I think you might like it. I felt the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Down in my heart. Down in my heart, I have the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Down in my heart to stay. You know what? And I'm so happy, so very happy. I have the love of Jesus in my heart. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I have the love of Jesus in my heart. You have the joy in your heart. You know, so often we come to worship and we look like joy is like the furthest thing on our mind. You know what I mean? Now I know it's early in the morning, but we got Jesus. If anyone should make us happy, it's Jesus Christ. Now there's a part where I need some help from you all. There's a question there. So I need you to join me in that question, maybe sing along. So it goes something like this. I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. And here's the question. Where? Down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart. Where? Can you help me out with that? Let's try it. I have the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart. Can't hear you. Down in, I can't hear you. I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart to stay. Now can you sing it? And I'm so happy, so very happy. I have the love of Jesus in my heart. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I have the love of Jesus in my heart. Clap too, that won't hurt you. Passage today says, make a joyful noise. There's not a person here, you're going to hear this in the sermon, that can't make a noise. Even Bob Turner here can make a noise. Just ask Peggy. So turn to your neighbor and say, I've got joy in my heart. Because I have Jesus. And then sing it with me. I have the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart. I have the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart to stay. Now why? And I'm so happy, so very happy. I have the love of Jesus in my heart. I thank you, Lord. Way through it, it's all about joy. The psalm that we read, Psalm 100, it is all about joy, isn't it? It says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All the earth. Other translations say, shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. There's the implication of psalm there. Other translations say, sing a joyful song to the Lord all the earth. It's no wonder this song reminds us of joy and the importance of it, that in church tradition, in some church traditions, this was known as the jubilant, because it's full of jubilee, isn't it? And it was often either read or sung after the gospel lesson. So as that song reminded, we have the joy in our heart because of Jesus Christ. So they would read the gospel lesson, story about Jesus, and then they would say, shout to the Lord joyfully all the earth. It fits really well, doesn't it? But today I want to focus just on one facet. I know we have communion and we have a full service, but I want to focus on one facet of this song. And the facet I want to focus on is the outward focus of this psalm, as opposed to the inward focus. I mean, the psalms we often read as spiritually edifying, and they are that. We often read them as having to do with the church or the body of Christ or the chosen people of Israel, and they have, you know, something to say about that, and psalms are meant to be read in that way. But sometimes with some of the psalms, and especially with this psalm, we miss the outward focus of this psalm. And we sometimes overlook it. We say the words and we forget. The psalmist begins with these words. He says, Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth. You see, this psalm just isn't about you and me. It's just not about us making a joyful noise here, although that's important. But it really is an invitation to all the earth, isn't it? All the earth. Other translations say all the lands, the whole world. I'd extend it to say the cosmos. This psalmist is inviting the whole cosmos to just worship and praise the Lord. Kind of like Jesus when he came in on Palm Sunday. He said, if you don't praise me, the rocks are going to call out. And the psalmist is inviting you and me and in the whole earth to praise him. And why? What he tells us why we can have such joy in our lives, because we know God. We know the God revealed through Jesus Christ. He says, know that the Lord is God. It is he who has made us, and we are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Isn't that a wonderful image? Think of the 23rd Psalm, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. The psalmist is drawing on that powerful image of God as your shepherd and my shepherd. And when we know that, it doesn't matter what the world throws at us. We can be full of joy. We can be with Paul in the prison, just praising the Lord, no matter what our circumstances are. In fact, there's something interesting. Did you know that thankfulness comes from an Anglo-Saxon root that has to do with thoughtfulness? To be thankful is to be thoughtful. For us as Christians, because we know God revealed in Jesus Christ, because we are thoughtful of that, what? We can be thankful at all times and in all places. See, many suggest that this psalm was a processional psalm that the children of Israel would use as they processed up to the temple. And in a way where they demonstrated that outward focus, I mean, you can imagine in your minds, right? Enter the gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise, give thanks to him, bless his name, right? Here's that thoughtfulness again. For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, his faithfulness is extended to all generations. But the thought often is, as they process up into that point, when they would say, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth, they would turn to the outside world. And they'd make a big holy racket, inviting them all to be a part of it. They disturbed the peace with the joy of the Lord. Do you see the image in your mind? I know Sheriff Pete might get mad, but I'm saying we as followers of Jesus Christ should be those who disturb the peace with the joy of the Lord. With the joy of the Lord. We invite others to be a part. Because when you think about it in these terms. I mean, why did they make such a noise, such a racket? Why are we called to do that? I mean, part of it is sometimes you got to get a little rowdy because it doesn't express our emotions, right? It's tough for us to really believe that the joy is in you when you're going, joy, joy, joy. On my heart. Yeah. Yeah. So sometimes you got to let it out, don't you? I was singing this song this week. I don't know if my neighbors, good neighbors there, heard me, but I was singing and dancing around my house with the joy of the Lord. It was good as I practiced that song. But so why? Why make such a racket? Well, part of it is it expresses our emotion. But I want to suggest to you and me, a big part of it is so that we disturb the peace, so that others hear that joyful noise and they go, huh, what's that? Ethel, what's going on up there at Asbury? A lot of noise. And when things are disturbed, people get curious, don't they? They get nosy. And so we want to make so much noise and have so much joy that they get nosy. Oh, I might have to go to church, Ethel, and just see what those Methodists are up to. You know what I'm talking about? So the psalmist reminds you and me that we make a joyful noise in part to express our emotions, but in part to invite the whole world, to evoke some curiosity, to get them wondering what in the world is going on with that church and what in the world is going on with that individual. How can they be so joyful in such trying circumstances? You see the question it kind of raises with them? In fact, I would suggest that this psalm really, really encourages you and me to be an invitation to the outside world. It's just not a matter of the Lord inviting, but you and me to live an invitational sort of life. A life that so overflows with joy that others pause and they go, wow, well, there's something different about him. There's something different. Have you ever known somebody with the joy of the Lord in them? There's something different about them, isn't there? You can't put your finger on it, partly because it's the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit blows where he wants to and goes where he wants to, but there's something different about it. And so, in a way, our psalmist, I want to suggest, is inviting you and me to be a living invitation to the world around us because the joy overflows out. And so we invite people. We live a beautiful life, especially as followers of Jesus Christ. When something is beautiful, you don't sit there and analyze it, do you? When you're standing before a sunrise, God, one of God's great creations, or when I was standing before the Grand Canyon, I didn't go, oh, wow, it's 500 feet deep, and there's a river down there. No, you just stand there in awe, and you go, wow, thank you. And you praise the Lord. Our life should be that way. Your life and my life should be a beautiful life where we don't have to tell people about Jesus, but the beauty of our lives and the beauty of our lives together will attract people naturally. And I'm convinced increasingly in this postmodern, post-Christian world we're living in, people don't need to hear us tell them anymore. What they need to see is the gospel of Jesus Christ embodied. They need to see the beauty of that life, and they'll be attracted to it. But don't tell me anymore. You Christians have been talking about it way too long. That's at least the secular mindset. They need to experience it. And the first place they can experience it is by you and me being joyful. And joy is contagious, isn't it? I just saw it when we sang that song. There were a few people like, what's she up to? By the end of the song, they're clapping. And they're going, where? Where? That's our lives. That's your life and my life. And the psalmist, I think, is inviting us to do that. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Enter into his presence with singing. And so we should do that as we leave here. We should do it every Sunday. Our lives should just be like an overflowing cauldron of joy Does that mean everything goes well in our lives, folks? Did it go well for Jesus and the disciples? No. Did it go well for Paul? No. But because they knew the Lord, they had a peace, I would even add a joy, that surpassed understanding. The world doesn't understand that sort of thing. How can you be joyful when this is happening to your life? Well, I have Jesus Christ. So how can you and I have a beautiful life? I just want to make a few suggestions. How can you and I be an open, living invitation to Jesus Christ? How can you and I embody that sort of life? How can we as a church live so that people go, something's happening over there, Ethel. We need to go and check it out. How can we live that kind of life? Well, I would start by saying that you and I need to make sure that our hearts are right. You know, you can do the fake joy thing. And I hate to say it, but I think there are some churches and pastors out there that do that. You know, that have the plastic smiles and all of that. But anyone who's truly searching can smell a skunk a mile away. It's like when I go up and lead the children in worship at Little Asbury, they can tell who's authentic and who. Children see through that, and people who are spiritually seeking can see through that fakeness. And so you and I need to make sure that our hearts are right. That part I mentioned where it says, know that I'm the Lord your God, it is I who has made you. You are my people, the sheep of my pasture. Some say that that's a lot more emphatic in the Hebrew. They say something like this, that it really should be rendered, make no mistake about it. Don't even doubt it. I am the Lord thy God. I have made you, and you are the sheep of my pasture. You are my people. It's strong like that. So we have to remember that we need to make sure that our hearts are grounded in the knowledge and the wisdom that God loves you and me through Jesus Christ. You see, you can't worship somebody you don't know. You can't love somebody you don't know. And so we need to know that that's the God that we follow. And out of that, we'll begin to worship. And so we have to remember that. The old Westminster Confession, Catechism, went something like this. The question was asked, what's the chief end of man? They didn't have inclusive language. So men, what's the chief end of all of us? And the response of those going through the catechism was this, to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. That's the end game for you and me, to glorify God. And so if we can't worship the Lord now, if we can't have that joy come out of us now, then we need to make sure that our hearts are right, because that's the end game. To enjoy God and to worship him forever, because he deserves our praise. There are the five solas of the Protestant Reformation. We're Protestants, right? They were sola scriptura, the Bible alone. Sola fide, faith alone. Sola gratia, grace alone. Solus Christus, Christ alone. And finally, soli Deo Gloria, to God be the glory alone. So all that we do should glorify God. And so if your heart's not right, if you're not able to glorify the God, ask God to put that joy in you. Get your heart right, because you're not going to be able to truly worship unless you get it right. With that, I would suggest we need to make sure that our hearts are willing. We need to make sure our hearts are, what do I mean? I mean, we need to make sure that our hearts are willing to face whatever may come our way. I've seen a lot of Christians, I believe, they follow God because they think everything's going to go right in their lives. It's not going to happen. Jesus was crucified. Jesus told you and me that God causes the sun to rise on the good and the evil and rain to fall on the righteous and the unrighteous. Bad things happen to good people, but we can still be joyful. But we need to commit and say, I've committed myself to this God. I've committed myself to Jesus Christ. It's kind of like marriage. That's why he calls it the bride. I say to some young people when I'm counseling them, if you're not willing to face the cost of marriage, then don't get married. Don't get married. Because there are going to be sacrifices along the way. It's all worth it. But if you still want to be a single man and live that single life, don't get married. But if you want to enter into a deep, abiding relationship where you actually get to know one other person and learn to love one other person, then do it. But be committed to it. Be committed to it. We need to remember that. We need to commit ourselves. In the Bible, love is more about an act of the will than it is about an emotional response. There was a little girl who wanted her dad to get her the world, to get a globe. This was years ago. And he got it, but she responded with these words. She said, "Oh, Daddy, I wanted a lighted world." She wanted a globe with a light in it. But then she responded, continued with these words, "But I suppose a lighted world costs more than we could afford." Bringing the light of Jesus Christ in the world can be costly, folks. I'm not going to lie to you. As John tells us, the world is dark. And there are people who live in the dark, and they like the dark. You know, when people live in the dark for a long time, their eyes adjust to the dark. And what happens when the light comes in? Ah! When we bring in the joy of the Lord around, that's how some people respond. Ah! I don't want to hear it. So we need to just be willing, steel our hearts, and say, "I'm committed to following through with the Lord." Bringing the light of Christ, the joy of Christ in the world around us, sometimes creating a racket gets us in trouble. Some folks, I hate to tell you this, are just party poopers. You know what I mean? Some people, even in church, are party poopers. It's like we say, "Have the joy." And it's like, "Come on, get the joy." How long have you been going to church? And you can't smile. You can't say thank you, Jesus. You can't dance and clap a little bit. What's wrong with you? They're just party poopers. And we love them. We love them. But we just need to be aware of that. And some of the world are just party poopers. They will rain on our parade every time. They don't want to hear about the joy of the Lord. They want to debunk the joy of the Lord. They want to dismiss the joy of the Lord. They want to say it's all in our head. It's all, you know, just be aware of it. So commit yourself. Be willing for the sacrifice. Commit yourself to go deeply in the Lord, to know the Lord and experience that joy, but know that the world isn't always going to receive it or understand. Some folks in the world are demonic. Have you ever known somebody that they just can't let somebody else be happy? They just can't. I heard a news article on the radio, and this young gentleman was trying to break the cycle of the ghetto in Los Angeles. And so he got involved with the arts and creating art. And he said he'd have to hide that art because the gangs and the bullies, they didn't want him to be happy. And they'd take his art and they'd smash it. And they'd go up to him and say something like this, "What's that smile on your face? Take it off." That's demonic. You can't imagine a picture of the devil smiling, can you? Doesn't happen in hell. But in heaven, can you see it? Everybody's got a smile on their face. The joy is overflowing. So there's a dynamic here. There's a spiritual battle going on here we need to be aware of. Sometimes out there, people are going to try to rain on your parade, and it's because they're just children of the darkness. We love them. We hope that the light, their eyes can adjust. We invite them to join in, but some will just, they just want to snuff it out. So here's the bottom line. I'm rambling this morning, but I'm excited and I'm full of the joy of the Lord. We make sure that our hearts are right and willing so that our hearts can be joyful. That's the bottom line. There's nothing worse than a boring, joyless, and awkward party made up of boring, joyless, and awkward people. And sometimes the church comes off that way, doesn't it? We ought not to be that way. Yes, sometimes we've got to get serious and all the rest, but there should be a joy that's flowing from underneath, right? Should be joy that's coming from underneath. And it doesn't matter about circumstances. I was with Preston Brown as he went into glory, and he was one of the most joy-filled person after he had struggled with Lou Gehrig's disease. He kept saying, "Pastor, I can't wait until I get my glorified body." I was with Donna Jean Corbett in the hospital, that we were making a joyful noise as she was on her deathbed. Why? Because she had the joy of the Lord within her. It doesn't matter about circumstances. It's about having that connection and that relationship with through Jesus Christ. That's why the psalmist says to you and me, did you notice all these are commands? He doesn't say, think about making a joyful noise. he doesn't say, you can do it sometime now. He says, why? Do it. Right now, I command you, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. He's commanding us. You want to know an interesting statistic? Scientifically proven. Those people who sing are happy. They've proven if you're in the choir, you tend to be happier. If you even sing in your car, Bob Turner, he's happier. God gave us voices to sing. Is there any singing in hell? No way. Hell no! But here, amongst the saints, we sing, right? I have the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Wait, down in my heart. Wait, down in my heart. I have the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart. To say why? And I'm so happy, so very happy. I have the love of Jesus in my joyful noise to the Lord. Let's pray. Gracious and loving Lord, help us to be people who are full of joy. Not full of ourselves. Not full of what the world has to offer, because there's no joy out there. People are seeking it. But help us to be full of the joy that only you offer. Lord, you give us the peace that passes understanding. And you invite us just to sing your praises and to walk in the fullness of your love and grace. And so help us as individuals, Lord. And there are some folks struggling today, and Lord, we don't make light of that. We know that sometimes it's hard just to muster up the strength just to make it to church. But Lord, I just ask on behalf of all of us that we have some sense of the joy of the Lord today. And we keep this psalm in our mind at all times. This invitation that you have for us to make a joyful noise unto you, all the earth. To come into your presence with gladness and to worship with our whole hearts and our whole beings. We just pray and ask all this in Jesus' most precious and holy name. Amen. Amen. Amen.